Assalamualaikum. Welcome to all of you in this second recorded lecture for the week number 6. In first recorded lecture, we have discussed the principle of the SP log, and we have seen that this SP log generates in the reservoir whenever there is a difference of salinity between the mud and the formation water. And in the first recorded lecture, we have also seen the basic use of the SP log, and the basic use of this SP log is the identification of the permeable zone. We have seen that whenever we have deflection from the shale baseline, whether deflection is on the left side or on the right side, the deflection will indicate that this zone is the permeable zone. So we have also seen that deflection is on the left side or on the right side. It depends on the difference of salinity between the mud and the formation water. The second use of this SP log is the calculation of RW. The RW is the resistivity of the water, and whether it's the connate water or the free water in the aquifer. So RW basically is the resistivity of the water, formation water, and RW calculation is very important for the estimation of SW, saturation of water. SW basically is calculated generally through the Archie equation, and for that calculation of SW we need RW. So RW is very important. It gives you SW, and from SW we can calculate saturation of hydrocarbons. And once we have the saturation of hydrocarbons, we can calculate the initial hydrocarbons in place. So RW will ultimately give us the initial hydrocarbons in place. And as you can see that basically this is the formula to calculate RW. And in this formula we need SSP, K and RMFE. And SSP, we have seen SSP that SSP, the static spontaneous potential, this is the maximum deflection one can see against a clean thick sandstone containing water. And we have seen that the maximum deflection is always estimated through the shale baseline. And shale baseline is drawn across the SP responses of the shale zone. And for drawing the shale baseline, we have seen that we take use of the other log, especially gamma ray log. So first we draw the shale baseline, and from the shale baseline we see a deflection, the maximum deflection against the any zone, and that deflection is called SSP. So in order to estimate RW, the resistivity of the water, we need SSP, K is a constant, and RMF, which is resistivity of the mud filtrate. The resistivity of the mud filtrate is estimated in the lab, and it is estimated from the mud filtrate. So this number comes from the lab. SSP is read from the log, K is a constant. So by this equation we can calculate RW. And basically we can also calculate RW by using this method, and this method has few steps. And as mentioned over here, that first we need to read the value of SSP from the log, and basically SSP is the maximum deflection, and this deflection is against the clean thick water wet zone. Obviously we will see that why always we do not get SSP. There is always basically against some zone we get SSP, but in other zones we do not get the maximum deflection. So there is a reason why all zones do not give the full deflection. So first we need to read SSP from the log, then obviously we need to get RMF, and this RMF basically is provided with the log at the log header, and this RMF should be at the reservoir temperature. So if RMF has been measured in the lab and has been measured at the room temperature. So these RMF need to be corrected for the temperature. So this RMF should be used in reservoir temperature in this equation or the graphical extraction. So RMF basically is estimated in the lab and should be at reservoir temperature. If not provided in reservoir temperature, it should be corrected, as mentioned over here, that compute RMF at formation temperature. Then obviously we need to convert RMF to RMFT, because in this formula we need RMFE, the equivalent mud filtrate resistivity. So first we need to convert RMF to RMFE, and obviously we can calculate RWE from this equation. If we are using this equation, we can calculate RWE, and once we have calculated RWE, then we can calculate RW from RWE, from equivalent water resistivity to the water resistivity. And basically this is the example. For example, the RMF is provided to you. RMF is 0.36 at 150 degree Fahrenheit, and obviously this is reservoir temperature. So if RMF was not provided to us at reservoir temperature, we need to use a chart to calculate RMF at reservoir temperature. And this RMF basically is generally reported on the log header. So from the log header, basically you can see the RMF is reported at borehole temperature, at surface temperature, and other thing. So for our interest, RMF should be reported at reservoir temperature, bottom hole temperature. If basically RMF was not provided to us at reservoir temperature, we will use this chart. This chart is basically is used to correct the value of RMF for any temperature you want. So for example, you can see on x-axis you have temperature, and temperature is reported in two units, one in Fahrenheit, other is in centigrade. The temperature is reported in Fahrenheit and in centigrade, as mentioned over here. On one y-axis, on the right side, basically this is the resistivity, and these are different lines for different salinity. Similarly, on x-axis you also have the resistivity. So these are different lines for different saline water. So through this graph you can either calculate the resistivity of a particular saline water at different temperature, or if resistivity and temperature is known to you, you can use this graph to calculate the salinity of your formation water. Basically, we will see in the coming slides. This is the graph to basically convert RMF to RMFE or RWE to RW. And basically there are two correlation exist. So if salinity is less than 70,000 parts per million, basically you do not use any graph. You calculate RMFE through this equation. RMFE is equal to 0.85 time of RMF. So this is the formula to calculate the RMF equivalent. So if salinity of your water is higher than 70,000 parts per million, you use this graph to convert your RMF to RMFE. Again, RMFE is the equivalent mud filtrate resistivity. Again, you will use the same formula, same graph, to convert your RWE to RW. And you can see there are different lines for different temperature. So you should know your bottom hole temperature, you should know the RMF at your bottom hole temperature, and then you should know the salinity of your formation water, whether it's lower than 70,000 parts per million or higher than 70,000 parts per million. So accordingly, you will use either the equation or the graph to calculate RMF equivalent. And once you know the RMF equivalent, you will use this graph SP1 to calculate the RW equivalent. So RW for For RW equivalent, you need SSP. Again, this SSP has been read from the log. These are different lines for different temperature. This is basically the principle is simple. From the x-axis you will move vertically and reach to your bottom hole temperature, and from their point of contact you will reach to this y-axis by moving horizontally from the point of contact. And once you have reached here, you need to basically see RMF equivalent. And RMF equivalent has been calculated using this SP2 graph. So you know your you know the value of the RMF equivalent. So once you know the value of the RMF equivalent, from this y-axis you can reach to RMF equivalent and extend the line to read RW equivalent. So by this SP1 graph you can read RW equivalent. So SSP, temperature and RMF equivalent is needed to read RW equivalent. Again, now you know RW equivalent, and RW equivalent is known to you. So so you will use SP2 graph again to convert your RW equivalent to RW. And for using this graph, you enter into this graph from y-axis RW equivalent, you know the temperature, and from the point of contact you move vertically downward and read the value of RW from the x-axis. So this is the procedure of reading or calculating RW using the SP log. Again, you could have used this equation to do the same stuff, but since K is a constant and temperature dependent, so it is basically preferred that you do not use this equation, and instead of this equation you use this graphical method to estimate RW. Again, RW is very important because it gives you the saturation of hydrocarbon. So any variation in RW will affect the hydrocarbon in place, and since hydrocarbon in place is very important, you really want to calculate RW carefully. So this is basically the summary of the whole process. You read RMF and temperature from the log header, you convert RMF to correct value at reservoir temperature. Again, if needed, if this RMF is not provided to you at reservoir temperature, you will use this graph to convert your RMF to reservoir temperature. Again, we have seen that you can also use this graph to calculate the salinity of your formation water. Then you will use SP2 graph to calculate RMF equivalent, and by using SP1 graph you will calculate the RW equivalent, and again by using SP2 graph you will calculate RW. So for example, a log has been provided to you, and this is SP log, and as you can see, from the shale baseline to sand baseline the difference is 100 millivolt. So SSP value is provided to you. So as we have mentioned in the initial slide, that SP values are used comparatively used. So you can see that SSP value from the shale baseline to sand baseline is provided to you. Again, the shale baseline is lying against the SP response of the shale zone, and this line must have been drawn by comparing the shale response of other logs, for example gamma ray log and the resistivity log, and any deviation from the shale baseline will indicate the permeable zone and the maximum deflection against the clean sand stone is called SSP. So this is the SSP value, and this is 100 millivolt. And RMF, the resistivity of the mud filtrate, is provided to us which is 0.5 ohm meter, and again it is provided at the reservoir temperature or the bottom wall temperature, which is 100 degree centigrade. So the first step basically is to calculate the salinity of this RMF. Resistivity and temperature is given to us, and from this graph we can calculate the salinity. So on y-axis the resistivity value is plotted, and the resistivity is from 0.01 ohm meter till 3 ohm meter. So resistivity value is provided to us, and these are the different lines for different salinity, and on x-axis the temperature is given. Temperature scale is in centigrade and in Fahrenheit. So both scales of temperatures are plotted on x-axis. So we know the 100 degree centigrade and we know 0.5 ohm meter resistivity. So from x and y-axis we come to this point, and this point basically is lying on this curve, which has a salinity of around 4000 ppm. So these are different lines for different salinity, and the salinity is plotted over here. So salinity scale is from 300 to 300,000 parts per million. So from 100 degree centigrade and from 0.5 ohm meter, the point is lying on this point. So the salinity of the RMF is 4000 part per million. So if somehow you need to read the resistivity value at some other temperature, for example at 75 degree Fahrenheit, and we know that now salinity is 4000 ppm, so we will be moving on this salinity line, and we need the value of RMF at this temperature at 75 degree Fahrenheit for 4000 ppm. So now we will be using the Fahrenheit scale, and 75 degree Fahrenheit and 4000 ppm, the salinity is around 1.5 ohm meter. So through this graph you can measure salinity, as we have measured using temperature and RMF value. And if you know the salinity and temperature, you can calculate the resistivity at any desirable temperature. So for this saline water at around 75 degree Fahrenheit, the RMF value will be 1.5 ohm meter. So with decrease in temperature, the resistivity value increases. As you can see, the temperature was around 100 degree centigrade, RMF value was 0.5 ohm meter. So with decrease in temperature, the resistivity value increases. So you can see this graph basically is moving downward. So with increase in temperature on x-axis, the resistivity value for a particular saline water decreases. So now we know the value of RMF, we know the value of salinity. So we can use this graph to estimate RMF equivalent. So first we need to check whether salinity is less than 70,000 ppm or higher than 70,000 ppm. Obviously the salinity for our case is 4000 ppm, which is less than 70,000 ppm. So we will be using this relationship, that RMF equivalent is equal to 0.85 RMF. So we will be, basically RMF is provided to us, 0.5, we will multiply with 0.85, we will get the RMF equivalent 0.42. So we do not use this graph for now because the salinity is lower than 70,000 ppm. So RMF equivalent from this correlation is 0.42, and from this graph we will calculate the value of RW equivalent. So we know the value of SSP, which is 100 millivolt, we know the temperature, which is 100 degree centigrade. So from 100 millivolt we move upward and reach the temperature line of 100 degree centigrade, and from this point of contact we will move horizontally and reach here, and from this point we will see what is the value of RMF equivalent. So for our case the RMF equivalent is 0.42, so 0.42 will be lying between 0.4 and 0.5, so it will be here 0.42. So from this point to this point we will draw a straight line, and we will extend this straight line to read the value of RW equivalent from this line. So RW equivalent basically is drawn by basically plotting these two points and extending the line to this RW equivalent scale. So RW equivalent is 0.03, and from the SP2 graph we will convert RW equivalent to RW, and on y-axis RW equivalent is given to us, which is 0.02, which we have just estimated. So we enter into this graph from y-axis. The temperature is known to us, 100 degree centigrade. We will basically highlight the line which is of our interest, and from this point of intersection vertically downward to this x-axis and read the value of RW. So the value of RW is 0.035 ohm meter. So that's how you use SP log to estimate RW. Again, this number is very important, and from this RW we can calculate SW, and from SW we can calculate the saturation of hydrocarbon. And this is another use of the SP log. Through SP log we can calculate the volume of shale, and volume of shale calculated through this formula, which is 1 minus PSP divided by SSP, and SSP basically the static spontaneous potential, and we know that this is the maximum value of the SP log, and PSP is the value of the SP log at a particular zone where we are interested in calculating the volume of shale. So through this formula we can calculate the volume of shale, and we also know that we can calculate the volume of shale through gamma log also. And basically we calculate volume of shale through both method, and we compare the readings, and if the readings are closer to each other, which means the reading is reliable. And let's do an example. In this log section you have been asked to calculate the volume of shale in the shelly sand zone using the SP log. So basically we have been asked to calculate the volume of shale in this thick shelly sandstone zone, and basically the formula is known to us. This is the formula to calculate volume of shale, and for that we need two things. One is SSP and other is PSP. So SSP is the maximum deflection, which is against this thick clean sandstone. So basically the shale baseline and the sand baseline has been drawn. The scale is known to us, from minus 100 millivolt to 100 plus 100 millivolt, and we know that we have to use SP for the relative terms. So we need to read the SSP value from the shale baseline. So since there are 8 boxes, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, there are 8 boxes, and one box is equal to 25 millivolt. So the difference is 200, 200 divided by 8 will be 25 millivolt, and from the shale baseline the box is 3, around 3 boxes. So the SSP value in this log section is around 70 millivolt, which is basically will be used in this calculation. So SSP value is around 70 millivolt. Similarly, the PSP value, which is the value of the SP log in this thick shelly sandstone zone, so the value of PSP is around 2 boxes. So around 2 boxes means around 50 millivolt. So it is lower than 50 millivolt, so around 45 millivolt. So the value of PSP is 45 millivolt, and the value of SSP is around 70 millivolt. So SSP value is 70 millivolt. Again, the relative value has been is to be read. So from shale baseline the SSP value is 70 millivolt, and the PSP value is around 45 millivolt. You know the formula, and from the formula the volume of shale in this zone is around 36%. So the volume of shale in this thick shelly sandstone is around 36%. Again, this calculation will confirm the calculation we have already done through the gamma ray log. So in real world, we will be doing calculation through both gamma ray log and SP log, and will basically try to match the value of both log. So when SP log does not show its full deflection, as we have seen that against some zone we have the maximum deflection, against some zone we have the minimum deflection, against some zone we have deflection but not so maximum. So what are the point, what are the reason because of that we do not have the maximum or the full deflection? So these are some reason. Thin bed, if the zone is not so thick. Invasion, if we have the deep mud invasion. Shaly sand, if the sandstone is not clean and has some shale in their matrix. Lithology, if we have some basically resistive rock in between your porous sandstone. So because of the lithology, you do not have the full deflection, or you have the hydrocarbon in your porous and permeable formation instead of water. So because of these five reasons, many times we do not see the full deflection. So there are reasons when we do not basically have a single shale based line. So these are the case when basically the baseline shifts. As you can see in the top section, we have another we have a different shale based line, and in the bottom section we have a different baseline. So the baseline shifts when we have different salinities in a well, and generally this happens in a shallower well, because in the top section we have a different water salinity, and in the bottom section we have a different water salinity. So the water salinity changes in a given wellbore section, so the baseline will shift. So that's all from my side for this SP log, and basically now the next topic is the resistivity log. And basically resistivity log is very important because it helps in calculating the water saturation, and once we know the water saturation, we can calculate the initial hydrocarbon in place. There are other uses of the resistivity log also, such as indications of lithology, identification of hydrocarbon and water bearing zone, correlation, determination of the overpressure zone, determination of the shale porosity, indication of the compaction, and the investigation of source rock. So these all are the uses of the resistivity log, and the most important one is the calculation of the water saturation, which ultimately helps in calculating the initial hydrocarbon in place. This is a typical resistivity log values. As you can see, against the shale formation, which is impermeable formation, we have low resistivity. Against the porous sandstone containing water, we have the low, basically lower resistivity. Against the tight formation, tight means it has lower porosity and low permeability, the resistivity value is high. Against the hydrocarbon, we also see higher resistivity. Against the salt water zone, we basically have lower resistivity value. So generally resistivity value varies with lithology and with the fluid content. For salt water, the resistivity is low, and for the fresh water, resistivity is high. For hydrocarbon bearing zones, the resistivity value is high. And as you can see, generally we basically measure resistivity at different zones of reservoir. In this log section, two resistivity log has been run. One is measuring the shallow resistivity, and other is measuring the deep resistivity. We will see the use and the purpose of measuring the resistivity of the formation at different depth of investigation. For example, shallow resistivity is measuring around 1 foot of the formation, and deep resistivity is measuring around 3 feet of the formation. So we measure resistivity at different zones in the formation at a particular depth. One is, for example, shallowest, other is shallow, and other is deep. And we will see the use of that. So resistivity value changes with lithology, with the fluid content. And in the coming slides, we will see how resistivity value changes. So first of all, what is resistivity? And we know that, first of all, resistance in ohms of 1 cubic meter of formation as measured in the classical method using Ohm's law is defined as the formation resistivity. It is usually referred to as RT in equation. All resistivity tools are calibrated to read formation resistivity in Ohm's meter. If RT is equal to 10 ohm meter, then 1 cubic meter of this formation will have a resistance of 10 ohms across the opposite faces. So resistance unit is ohm and resistivity is the resistance of a 1 cubic meter of formation is called resistivity. And we know the formula V is equal to IR. So for example, if you apply a current and measure the voltage drop across this zone, so by this formula, the Ohm's law, we can calculate the resistance. So V divided by I, V is the voltage drop and I is the constant current that is applied from the source. So R is the resistance. So by measuring the voltage drop across this rock, for example, we can calculate the resistance of this rock. And the resistance of 1 cubic meter of formation is the resistivity, and the unit of resistivity is ohm meter. So resistivity, as I have mentioned before, changes with the fluid content and with porosity and with other parameters which we'll be discussing in the coming slides. So the first important parameter is the salinity of the water. So if the rock contains the saline water, the resistivity of that rock will be low, because salt means the ions. So when you apply the current, basically this rock will offer less resistance to the current as compared to the case when the same zone contains the fresh water. So when the zone contains the saline water, the resistivity of that rock is low because the current can easily move through this rock. Obviously, when the same rock contains hydrocarbon, this is a typical case when you discover the pay zone, the majority of the pore space should be occupied by the hydrocarbon, and there is some area or pore space that is occupied by the cuneate water, the water that is stick to the grain surface that couldn't be displaced by the hydrocarbon. So at the time of discovery, the pay zone contains majority of the hydrocarbon and some cuneate water, and that cuneate water is called the interstitial water or the initial water. And the volume of this cuneate water ranges from 5% to maybe 50%. So the lower the SW, the lower the value of the cuneate water, the good is for petroleum engineering, which means the higher volume is occupied by the hydrocarbon. Generally, the typical number of the cuneate water is around 20%. So 20% pore space is occupied by the cuneate water, and remaining 80% space is occupied by the hydrocarbon. So basically, when you measure the resistivity of your pay zone, which is mostly occupied by the hydrocarbon, and some area is occupied by the cuneate water, the resistivity of that zone is high as compared to the zone which only contains the saline water, because the current now cannot pass through this rock easily, because the hydrocarbons do not have The ions, hydrocarbons are insulator, they are not conductive. Similarly, the rock grain, majority of the rock grains are insulator, which means they do not provide the path for the current flow. So the path of the current flow basically for most of the formation is in the pores and water in the pores. So for the pay zone, rock grains are insulator, hydrocarbons are insulator. The current path will only be through this saline water, which is very limited. So the resistivity of the pay zone of the hydrocarbon zone is higher. So first thing, resistivity changes with the fluid content. Resistivity is lower for water zone, resistivity is higher for the hydrocarbon zone. So RT is the resistivity of the formation, and R naught basically is the resistivity of the formation containing the water only. So when basically the rock contains water plus hydrocarbon, we will call RT. But when the same formation, for example aquifer, contain the water, we will call R naught. So RT will be equal to R naught for aquifer zone, but for hydrocarbon zone we will only call this resistivity is RT. For water zone we can call it RT or R naught, both are same. Just to differentiate between the resistivity value of the aquifer zone or the pay zone. And resistivity of the 100% formation water, when no rock is present, is called RW, which means that resistivity of the water sample is called RW. So RW is resistivity of water, R naught is the resistivity of the rock contain this water, and resistivity of the rock contain hydrocarbon and the water is called RT. So these are three symbols used, and we will see that these symbols will be used in the equations. We have seen this graph, and we know that through this graph we can calculate the salinity of the formation water at a given temperature. And if temperature and salinity known to us, we can use this graph to calculate the resistivity of the water. So through this graph we either measure salinity or we measure the resistivity, and we have seen this graph in studying this the SP law. Basically there are other parameters that also affect the resistivity of the formation. The important thing is the porosity. So if porosity of the rock changes, the resistivity changes. With decrease in porosity, obviously the volume of fluids inside the rock will change. For example, considering that the rock contains the saline water, but the porosity of this rock is lower as compared to the rock we have discussed previously. Imagine the fluid, the saline water is same in both rock, but the porosity has changed. So with decrease in porosity, now you have less volume of fluid, and since you have less volume of saline water, the current path will reduce, and because of the reduction in current path, the resistivity will increase, as you can see. So the resistivity will increase with the decrease in porosity. Obviously salinity, when salinity changes, the resistivity of water changes, and since this water is in the rock, the resistivity of the rock will also change with the change in salinity. So decrease in salinity, increase RW, and increase RW means increase RT, and vice versa, increase in salinity will decrease RW and will also decrease RT. We have seen in this graph basically with increase in salinity, resistivity decreases. So for example, for a particular temperature these are different lines for different salinity, and salinity is decreasing from top to bottom. So the top line is for lower salinity and the bottom line is for the highest salinity. So with decrease in salinity at a particular temperature will decrease the resistivity of the water. So with increase in salinity, RW decreases, and the rock that contains that high saline water, the resistivity of that rock will also decrease.